Hi, this is Pastor Kevin with Journey of Faith, Foursquare Christian Church. I just wanted to take a moment and thank you for logging on today to watch our video podcast as we explore God's Word and apply it to our lives. You know, it's so important for our walks that we spend time each day in God's Word to get to know Him and get to grow in Him. With all of my teachings, I have a sermon handout that is used during the message. It contains scriptures and fill-in-the-blank sections for you to follow along with. You may obtain this handout by logging onto our website that is listed on the screen. Go to our resources section and choose study materials. I hope and pray that God's Word will speak to you today, and thank you for joining the journey.
Salvation, healings, I mean, blessing upon blessing upon blessing. And, but they're all like spiritual. They're not tangible. But God has given us a tangible, physical, something you can touch gift. In Ephesians chapter 4, he said he gave gifts to the church, and one of them, the pastor, is a gift. And so, Pastor, if you would come. And Janine, Miss Janine, I want to ask the boys because preachers' kids hate to be brought up. So I don't want the girl hating you guys. So on behalf of the church, we have just a little token of our appreciation. And I want to thank you so much. You are just a great, great gift of God to each and every one of us. And we'll dismiss this way. You know, you can normally the pastor prays for you and blesses you. Today, come up, everybody just come up and wish them a Merry Christmas and pledge your allegiance and your faithfulness. God bless you.
Thank you.
And Merry Christmas.
Thank you very much.
So, everybody could just come up and just
in one night, shorten it, just give you the real quick rundown of what Advent is about, and then hopefully then we can go and we can expand on it at a later time. So Advent is something that's been done for about 1500 years, and if you've done Advent before, you go like, that doesn't look like Advent. It's usually in a circle, and it's usually only three colors. I have five colors, but this is the candle holder I've had for many, many years, and it's got five, then that's what I need. And for me, I like having a different color for each candle so that we can remember what each candle represents. And so I color code them like that for me. Maybe that's part of my children's ministry training, I don't know. That's the way I like to do things. So at this point, we've all decorated our homes and we've got everything ready, but some of us still need to decorate our hearts for Christmas. Some of us still need to do that fine-tuning so that we're truly looking forward in anticipation to celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. And that's what Advent is all about. It's looking forward to something that is great and magnificent. And so tonight we're going to do these five candles, and each one has a different representation. And the blue candle reminds us that Jesus' life did not start in a manger. How do we know that, kids? His life did not start when he was born in a barn and laid in a manger. When did his life start? In heaven. He's always been there, right? He didn't just start on the scene. I mean, he wasn't born in a sense that his life began. He had already been alive in heaven. So that's what the blue candle represents for us. Is that he's more than just a man that was born in a stinky barn, but in fact he is the eternal God. Now, the Jewish people don't have a problem, either in biblical times or in today's times, of remembering that Jesus was a man. But they do have a problem with recognizing him as God. Sometimes, as Christians, we have the opposite problem. We so often see Jesus as God that we forget that he was also truly a man, a real man. And not just a good man, and more than just a good teacher, but and more than a prophet, but he is a man, and yet he is God with us. Emmanuel. Emmanuel has come. And so even as the shepherds and the wise men came and bowed down to this baby, why did they do that? Because they recognized that he was more than a human being. But he desired and deserved our worship. And we deserve to worship him this day as well. The pink candle, on the other hand, reminds us that Jesus truly was a man. That he was born of a woman, and that he spent time in the womb, and he, throughout his lifetime, lived as a man, okay? He did not use his godly attributes when he was on the earth. It says in Philippians 2, 6 through 8, in this one version, it says, he had equal status with God, but he didn't think so much of himself that he had to cling to the advantages of that status no matter what. No, not at all. When the time came, he set aside the privileges of deity, took on the status of a slave, became human, and having become human, he remained human. It was an incredibly humbling process. He didn't claim special privileges. Instead, he lived a selfless, obedient life, and then died as a selfless, obedient man. So that's what the scripture says to us. So when we read of all the miracles that Jesus did when he was on earth, he was not doing them in his own power. He had to rely on the Father because he was giving us an example that we too can have that power if we will rely on God. God became human so that he could identify with us. But it took 33 years for us to understand that we can identify with him. And so, and the amazing thing is that we have this God, fully man, come together to be our Savior. And that's what the red candle is about, obviously, is that we've got to remember the very purpose of Jesus coming to earth was not to be born. His purpose was so that he could one day die for us and that he could be our Savior. John the Baptist was a very popular man when he was 30 years old. And a lot of people were following him and saying, oh, you must be the one. You are so wonderful. And he said, no, I must decrease. He must increase. Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And so we see that Jesus is total and complete in what he has done for us as both man and God coming together so that he can be our Savior. Now, the purple candle helps us remember that this plan has been from the beginning and it has never changed. If you look in Genesis 3:15, we have the first promise of a Savior that's going to come. And then we have in John 3:16 the explanation of what it is. That he loved the world so much that he sent his only son, right? So we have the complete picture, and it never, ever changed. And throughout the entire Bible, God didn't have to change his plan up. He didn't say, oh my gosh, what did those people do? I got to change things around. He didn't have to change anything. He already knew everything was going to happen. You guys have any idea how it is that the wise men knew? How did the wise men know that that star in the east meant that a special king had been born and that they needed to make this trip across several countries to come and see him when the people of Israel didn't even understand what was happening? How did this wise man know? They weren't even Jewish. How did they know? What do you think? An angel called them? Could have been. Bible doesn't say that, yes?
Because of the promise that God made in the beginning.
Because of the promise that, but that would mean that they'd have to know about the Bible, right? For them to know. Do they know about the Bible? There's a real good chance that these wise men knew the scriptures. You know why? 600 years before the birth of Jesus, the Jewish nation was conquered by the Babylonian Empire, and they were taken as slaves. And there was a man named Daniel who was a very godly man that served the Lord with all of his heart. And the king saw that he was such a special, wise guy for such a young man. He was so wise. He had so much knowledge. He was perfect. He appointed him to be the leader of the wise men. And he told him, teach them everything you know. So do you think it's possible that Daniel told them about what the Bible had to say about a Messiah was coming? Do you think it's possible that these wise men from generation to generation passed on this hope that a Messiah would be born? And when they saw the star, they knew that that was the fulfillment of the promise. But that happened 600 years before. But our God is eternal. His life is everlasting. His plan has never changed. So he set it up 600 years ago so that the people in Babylon, which I... You know where Babylon is? It would be Iran for today. The people from there came to Israel to worship the King of Kings. Which is one of the reasons I think that there's so much turmoil in that country. So, we have God. We have Jesus who is God. We have Jesus who is man. Combine the two, he became our Savior. And that plan has been going on since the beginning of time. God made that plan. So tonight we celebrate that we know that that promise has been fulfilled and that the light has come into the world. The light is here. And I love the lights at Christmas time. You guys, you guys ever go out in your car and go look at the lights? Yeah? Yeah, isn't that cool? I love to do that. I love to go out and look at all those lights. You go to our house, we live in an apartment, but there are lights on every window, you know, so that the people that are walking by can see the lights. We have lights out on our porch. We have lights, obviously, on a tree. Yes? Oh, good. So you got some awesome lights. Yeah? Well, we have something like that too, yeah. We can change them. Yeah, that's cool. They come out with all these amazing, every year they come out with new kind of lights, don't they? So you can buy them and, you gotta dish up some money and get the newest lights out there so that whether they're on your tree or on your house. But lights are a representation to us. Jesus is the light of the world. It's interesting that tonight is not only being celebrated by the Christians, it's also being celebrated by the Jewish people tonight, because tonight is the first night of Hanukkah. And for those of you that don't know the Hanukkah story, what happened was a couple hundred years before Jesus was born, there was this king who tried to destroy the Jewish faith. And so he killed a lot of the people and he destroyed the temple. But there was this group of men that came that rose up and said, no, we are not going to let this happen. And they're called the Maccabees, and they started fighting against the king. And at one point, they were able to take back their temple. And so they cleaned it up, and they set up the menorah, which is, have you ever seen the menorah lights? There's eight of them, actually there's nine, there's one in the middle. And they set the menorah, and they lit the candles, but the menorah is lit by, oil, okay? It doesn't have wax, oil. But because the temple had been destroyed, there was only enough oil for one night. And they thought, okay, we're going to order some more oil, but it's going to take like 8 days before it gets here. What are we going to do? And so the legend says that that light continued to stay lit for the entire 8 days. And so you have the the Jewish people on Hanukkah celebrate their, similar to our Christmas, they celebrate it for 8 days. And every night they light another candle, and every night they give out presents. How would you like that? 8 days of presents, huh? So that's what they do. So, but the thing is the sad part is that the Jewish people are gathering tonight. We have friends and family members that are Jewish. They're gathering tonight to remember, first of all, the heroic efforts of the Maccabees and how they were able to conquer this evil king. We are here tonight to celebrate that our king has conquered sin and conquered death. The Jewish people are there tonight to celebrate the fact that the light, which was a symbol, the presence of God, had been restored to their building. We are here tonight to celebrate that Jesus is the light of the entire world. And the amazing thing is, in Matthew, Jesus even turned to the people and he said, and you are the light of the world. So Jesus lights the world, and then we're kind of like the moon, you know? The moon doesn't have any light in itself, but it looks all bright in the sky at night. Why does the moon look bright in the sky if there's... Yeah, Daniel? Right, it's just a reflection, right? That's what we need to be. We need to be a reflection of the light. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right, yeah, it comes right back, bounces right back at you, right? We are the light of the world because Jesus is the light of the world, and he is going to reflect from our lives. So that is what Advent is all about, for us to anticipate the celebration of Jesus Christ, of all that he is. More than just a baby in the manger. He grew up to be a man, to be sacrificed for us. But a man in himself could not be our Savior. It took God and man together. Not half God, not half man. Fully God, fully man, in one person, sacrificed himself. The plan has been in existence from the beginning of time. So tonight we celebrate. It came to pass. The light is here. Amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this night, and we thank you, Lord, for these kids that are here to celebrate the true meaning of Christmas with us, Lord. I ask that you bless each one that is here tonight. Amen.
Now, as the kids go ahead and excuse themselves to go to class, we're going to take about 10 minutes, have some coffee, some tea, some cookies. I almost said donut, but we don't have donuts. And then when we get back, I have a funny story to tell you about how we almost became the light of Glendora today. So say hi to everybody, and then we'll get back here. I just wanted to make sure the audio was going to work. And as you can tell, I have a microphone in front of me, even though I have my headless on, so I didn't get it all right, but I came pretty close. So we opened up the door. I know, right? So we opened up the door. And the first thing I smell is this really strong gas smell. And so I'm like, oh no. And to show you how strong it was, my allergies are really acting up, so I'm not even smelling anything. It was that strong. Janine was still in the car. And of course, I don't know why I did it, by the grace of God, first thing I do is I flip on all the lights in the panel, I turn lights here and this and that, and I know there's a leak somewhere, and I'm trying to find it. And so Janine comes in, she says, oh my gosh, the smell. And so we discovered that it's in the oven. So what happened is they had an event here on Monday, and they obviously used the oven, and they didn't shut it off all the way. So for the whole week, nothing but gas has been filling this place. So I then proceed to plug in a bunch of fans to get this thing aired out. So any one of those, to be honest with you, should have blown us up. And even Janine, when she went to shut the oven off, if she would have turned the knob the wrong way, we could have blown ourselves up. So by the grace of God, I can tell you that it was God's plan and purpose for us to be here tonight, because along the way, we were trying really hard not to make that possible. So thank you, Jesus. And so when Debbie said, light of the world, I'm like, yes, we were almost, and so for the wrong reasons. And so, but I am so thankful that it was so strong. I'm so thankful that we came this morning, because if we would have come, let's say, like 3 o'clock this afternoon, to get everything ready, quite honestly, we would have had to cancel the service, because we were here for like 4 hours, and it took the full 4 hours of every window and door open in this place and every fan going to get rid of that smell. In fact, we were only in here for like 5 minutes this morning, and Janine had a headache, she was dizzy, she was nauseous, and so that, you know, we could have said that we were all spirit-filled, but in reality, I think it would have just been that we were all gasping that night. So thank you, Jesus, for that. Well, we are so glad that you were here with us tonight. And just one quick announcement. Tomorrow at 2 o'clock, we're going to be at Brookdale Retirement Facility in San Dimas. It's right off 57 on Via Verde. If you could join us, we're going to sing Christmas carols with the residents for an hour or two. And just let them know that we love them, and more importantly, that God loves them with that. And then we will have our normal Sunday worship next Sunday at 10 a.m., even though it's New Year's Day. The good news is there's not a lot of football on, so come join us here, and we'll get you home enough to watch some football. If you have your Bibles, please open up your Bibles to Luke chapter 2, and we're going to be looking at verses 8 through 14. And if you don't have a handout, or if you don't have a Bible, please raise your hand and we will get you the handout of the Bible. And if you don't want a Bible, please accept it as a gift from us to you. Now, I want you all to repeat after me. Doesn't that feel good? As Debbie said, it's been a chaotic time for everybody. And, you know, I think really this Christmas is really a foretaste of things to come. Because as Debbie mentioned, and I was going to talk about it, I have a really good friend who's Jewish, and I've known him since elementary school. And I had lunch with him about a month ago, and he said, this is the first time that I can remember where Hanukkah and Christmas fall on the same day. And to me, the reason why that is a foretell of things to come, because there's going to be a day when Christians and Jews alike celebrate Jesus as he was intended to be. So this is a really, I mean, we should really take notice of this. This is a special Christmas, because one day we will all celebrate Jesus and his birth as he intended it to be. And as you know, Christmas Day is almost here. It's ironic that we spend 364 days, it seems like, getting ready for those few hours on Christmas Day where we get together. There will be family gatherings, special meals, gifts, laughter with friends, and in a few short hours, it will all be over. The laughter, the joy, the meals, the gatherings, and the gifts. You know, there's a popular phrase at Christmas time, which is peace on earth. In fact, many Christmas songs talk about this peace. The song Hark the Herald Angels Sing, there's a line that says, Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace, hail the Son of Righteousness. Silent Night, the last line in Silent Night, which we will be singing later, says, Sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in heavenly peace. Many may see the sights and the sounds of Christmas, and in their own personal despair, they say, there is no peace on earth. But it's not just for us this particular year. In fact, people have been saying that for generations and centuries. Henry W. Longfellow, who was an American poet, wrote the song, I Heard the Bells of Christmas Day during the American Civil War. And a line in that song says, For hate is strong and mocks the sound of peace on earth, goodwill toward men. We seek and long for that peace on earth. So where can we turn to find that peace, especially at Christmas time? If you'd like to stand, we're going to read out of Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 14. And it'll be up on the screen, and you have it in your handout as well. And beginning in verse 8, it says, In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you, and you will find a baby wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger. And suddenly there appeared to the angel the multitude of the heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. You can go ahead and have a seat. And Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for this time. We thank you for your gift. We thank you for a Savior that was born in a manger so that he one day would die for our salvation. May you bless this time tonight. May you bless these families. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The heavenly host praised God and said, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth goodwill and peace among men. And as we say goodbye to 2016, I think one theme that we have all experienced is a lack of peace. There's a lack of peace in our own lives, maybe over regrets of past mistakes, struggles with present weaknesses, or worries about the future. And as you look at the world, we can say that there is worry, that there is no peace on earth as well. It sure seems elusive, and as each day goes by, it sure seems like it's harder and harder to find. But that is exactly what Christmas is all about. Peace. Peace on earth and peace among men. It seems that the angels had it right when they declared, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men. God desires a harmonious relationship between men and nations. God desires there to be peace on earth and peace among men. Yet despite this promise, despite what the Bible says, it seems that so many people are lacking that peace in their lives. As we learned last week, it was that first Christmas where the Lord prepared two babies. One who would prepare the world for the Savior, who was John the Baptist. And the other who would save the world as the Savior. And that was Jesus Christ. This baby, our Savior Jesus Christ, would do something in this world that had never been accomplished before. And that was, he brought peace among men. Jesus brought peace to us here on earth. And we should celebrate that and remember that at Christmas time. He brought peace among men, the angel said. But more importantly, he brought peace between God and us. In the song, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, it says, Glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Some would say, as the angels appeared to those shepherds in the field, that they did have peace. The Bible says that the shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. It was quiet. It was beautiful. It was peaceful. But yet Jesus brought peace among men, something that was missing and something that was needed. Jesus' birth brings peace between people. And perhaps that explains that around why Christmas time we seem to have so much goodwill towards other people. We seem to do things for other people that we normally wouldn't do. We seem to say things to people that we normally wouldn't say. Jesus brought peace to us on earth. And because of that peace, there is now a way opened up for us to have peace between God and ourselves. Yes, there will still be sin. And yes, we will still be powerless to completely overcome that sinful nature. But Jesus would be the payment for those sins. Jesus would be the peace for believers. And this peace is available to everyone, but given only to those who seek it through Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus came with a purpose. Ephesians 2:14 says, For he himself is our peace, who made both groups into one and broke down the barrier of the dividing wall. But Jesus also came with a plan. As he said in John 14:27, Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. And while Jesus brought peace to us that first Christmas, we can take comfort in knowing that Christ is still our peace today. The peace of God happens in our hearts when we have made peace with God first. Our scripture said the angel, a multitude of the heavenly hosts, were praising God in anticipation what Jesus would do. He would ultimately accomplish for man peace between God and peace between ourselves. And that's why Paul wrote in Romans 8:1, there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. We are no longer condemned by our sin because Jesus brought us peace with God. And I don't think we should just celebrate a baby that came into the world at Christmas time. We should celebrate a Savior that brought peace among men and brought peace between us and God. Yes, Christ is still our peace today. And the angels cried out, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased. That peace was given and is available to those with whom he is pleased. Only those who are his people can receive and rest in his peace among men. And it's only through a personal relationship with Jesus that God has made this peace available to those with whom he is pleased. We can live in peace because Jesus said, Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. And because Jesus left it and gave it to us, Christ is still our peace today. Peace has come to the earth, for our God is fully with us. And though he returned to heaven, he gave us a helper, the Holy Spirit, who shares with us that peace each day, so that we will never be without that peace again. I read a newspaper article that came out this week from a newspaper called The Evening Sun, which is in Florida. And the title of the article was, Where Does It Start? And it said, if so many of us want peace, why does it continue to evade us as a society? And why do we become so conflicted and so verbally combative when others don't share our ideas about, interpretation of, or methodology for finding peace? Doesn't it first have to start with that small, still voice that lies within each of us before we can expect the world to comply? Yes, we celebrate that peace does exist on Earth. And yes, peace does exist at Christmas. But as the writer of that article so notably wrote, it must first begin with us. If you need peace in your life, you must first need Jesus. In other words, if you don't know Jesus, you will never know the peace he gave to us that first Christmas morning. You will never know the peace that the Holy Spirit has for us on a daily basis. And it's my prayer for each and every one of us that this Christmas, that we don't just celebrate the Christmas story, but this Christmas, we will experience the Christmas story. As you take a look at your life, how would you describe it? Content, rushed, exciting, stressful, moving forward, holding back, or taking steps in the wrong direction? For many, it's all of the above. But how much peace do you truly have in your life? As the angels who met the shepherd long ago were singing, their message has carried through the ages. For today in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Longfellow was right. Yes, there will be tragedies bombarding your doorstep, yet there is still peace in the air. Longfellow finished his song with the following line, then rang the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor does he sleep. Peace on earth, peace on earth. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men. So despite the news that we read, despite what we see in our society, despite how you may feel inside, yes, peace is not only possible, but peace is available. Paul wrote in 2 Thessalonians 3:16, now may the Lord of peace himself continually grant you peace in every circumstance. The Lord be with you all. And it's my hope and prayer for all of us that the good feeling we have at Christmas is not just based upon the gifts we give or the gifts we get. Because unless we're confirmed to Christ and unless we have repented our sin and be baptized in his name, the peace we feel at Christmas will be gone as soon as we wake up that next morning. I pray that we all experience Christmas this year. Martin Luther King, which I believe is his last Christmas sermon, the title was A Christmas Sermon on Peace. And he gave this sermon 4 months before he was killed. And he said, with this faith, we will be able to speed up the day when there will be peace on earth and goodwill toward men. It will be a glorious day. The morning stars will sing together, and the sons of God will shout for joy. Let this Christmas be a celebration of peace, goodwill, and reconciliation, first with our God, so that we can have that with one another. Just as the world needed Jesus and peace that first Christmas morning, we too need that same Jesus and that peace today and every day after. So may this Christmas, and guys, if you want to come on up, may this Christmas be not only a blessed and joyous and merry time for you, but may this Christmas be a peaceful time for you as well. And I hope and pray that with each day that goes by, you will experience the peace of the Holy Spirit in your heart. Regardless of what your circumstances and situation may be, you will not be defined about what happens to you, but you will be defined by what happens in you. Yes, the world may do mean things to us. Yes, the world may try to hurt us. Yes, the world may try to break us down and wear us down. But there's one thing that the world can never do. It can never take away Jesus from us. And as long as we have that relationship with Jesus Christ, And as long as you allow the Holy Spirit to live inside you and guide you and lead you, you will always have peace in your heart. Peace towards men. And most importantly, peace with God. Now, it was my intention to actually do a candlelight ceremony tonight, but I found out late this week that we're actually not allowed to have lights in this place. And so what we're going to do is we're actually going to show you two videos, music videos, Mary Did You Know, and a song by Hillsong that talks about peace. And during this time, I want you just to sit and reflect. Maybe right now, as you're listening, you're saying, I don't have that peace in my life. Maybe right now, as I'm talking, you're already thinking about all the things that you have to do for the rest of the night and get ready for tomorrow. I want you right now just to rest in His peace and in His presence. I don't want you to sing to these two songs. You don't even really have to look at the video, but I want you just to rest. However that is, sit, close your eyes, whatever you want to do, but just rest in His presence. And then when we're done, we're going to sing Holy Night together, and we're going to have a modern version of a candlelight ceremony, and I'll explain that more to you. So Janine, go ahead, babe. We're going to close the lights down now and just rest in His presence for a while.
Yeah.
Christmas we celebrate that peace has come for our God, our King, our Savior, our Jesus Christ is with us. And so what we're going to do now is we're going to sing Holy Night, and we have Debbie and some of the kids are going to come up and lead us in that. And since we cannot have candles in here, and since we are in the 21st or 22nd century, I'm not sure which one it is, we have some electronic candles that we're going to hand out if you need one. But I thought it'd be really cool if we took out our cell phones and used the flashlight, right? We're all about moving forward, not back. So if you have your cell phone, if you want to take it out and do this, we're going to do it just like we do in concerts. If you don't have a cell phone and if you need a candle, we have candles for you. But I was joking with Janine and I said, at least this way we'll save some trees. But wax doesn't come from trees. I was joking with that. So let's get together. And as we sing this song, know that not only this night is silent, but because of His peace, our hearts can be quiet and silent as well.
We hope that you've enjoyed today's podcast. Journey of Faith is a Foursquare Christian church located in Glendora, California. For more information on Journey of Faith, visit us on the internet at www.thejourneyoffaith.net. That's www.thejourneyoffaith.net. You may also call us at 626-914-3400. And finally, we hope you will come visit us. Our Sunday morning service is at 10 a.m. We offer ministries for all ages, from newborns through high school during our service. May God bless you, and thank you for joining the journey.